Alzheimer's is a brain disease that causes a slow decline in memory, thinking, and reasoning skills. Our On the Move host, Donna Yeager, talks with two spouse caregivers, Betty MacDonald and David Morley. They became ambassadors for the Alzheimer's Association to help others cope with the disease and to help raise funds to support research for a cure. Now here's Betty and David with Donna.
Hi, I'm Donna Yeager with On the Move, and I'd like to welcome our very special guest, Betty MacDonald. Welcome, Betty.
Thank you very much.
And Dave Morley. Welcome, Dave.
Thank you. Nice to be here.
Thank you. Now, Betty, I'd like to ask the first question about when did you first notice the issues regarding your spouse?
Well, he was getting forgetful, doing silly things. But more importantly, he also felt that he was not functioning to the utmost of his ability. He felt that something was happening to him.
Okay. So probably like a year before? Yeah.
Oh, it was several years really before diagnosis.
Okay.
That he realized that something was going on.
Okay.
And then when we were feeling that it was really getting serious, we went to the doctor to get some help with what was going on.
Okay. And Dave, how about you?
I first noticed that Bonnie had always been my navigator in my car as I was driving. And all of a sudden one day, she couldn't tell me how to drive, where to go.
Oh, okay.
And so I said, oh, that's a change. So I then got a diagnosis 18 months later. So I noticed 18 months before diagnosis that there was a problem.
Right, yeah. But it was really prevalent in yours.
Then I started noticing many other things.
Right.
During those 18 months, yes.
Wow. And so what are some of the actual symptoms of dementia?
Well, first of all, is memory loss.
Yeah.
I mean, but memory loss can be normal.
Yeah.
You can have normal memory loss.
Mm-hmm.
But in Bonnie's case, it was memory loss, but she couldn't go back and trace her steps back. If she lost something, she couldn't go back and then
trouble with time. My husband had no idea. He would miss appointments. He would not be able to follow a calendar. They talk about the three C's, not cooking right, not being able to do your checkbook, and not being able to use a calendar.
Mm. Oh, my gosh.
Wow. Right.
All really important things.
Yeah.
It's activities of daily living, yes, right.
Right.
Well, Betty, what are the differences between aging versus dementia?
Well, like David said, there are things that are normal in aging.
Right.
But when it gets beyond that, when you lose something and you can't trace your steps as to where you did put your keys.
Right, yeah.
But if you can trace your steps, you're fine.
Yeah.
If you can't trace your steps, then maybe you're having a dementia problem.
Right.
So a cognitive kind of thing of putting action and motion together.
Okay.
And solving problems, trying to figure something out. I mean, whereas you could have done this for your entire life, and all of a sudden you're given a problem to solve and you can't do it anymore.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Well, actually, I have a quick story because my grandma Kay, lived in Chicago. And so my mom was not able to visit with her very often. But she, I don't think she was officially diagnosed, but it just got progressively worse with her not recognizing my mom and not remembering a lot of different situations. And that's her picture at my mom's wedding. Lots of wonderful memories.
Well,
I wasn't there yet, but anyway.
Alzheimer's wasn't diagnosed.
Right.
I mean, until just recently, and now we understand the magnitude of the issue.
Right.
You know, it used to be accepted that, oh, you get old and you just get forgetful, it's okay.
Yeah. Right.
But it's not okay, it's a disease where your brain physically changes.
Yeah.
So it is a disease, not just normal.
Right. And Betty, I forget, I'm sorry. What was the official time when you your husband was diagnosed?
My husband was diagnosed in 2005.
Oh, okay.
And we continued to travel. He was diagnosed first with mild cognitive impairment.
Wow.
And we continued to travel and carry on and lead a fairly normal life.
Okay.
And in 2008, three years later, then the symptoms of his disease were getting such that we needed to settle down and, and have a more structured life around John's illness.
Okay.
And my wife was diagnosed in 2008.
Right.
And she lived with me for 5 years.
Wow.
After diagnosis. And we, just as Betty and John, we traveled for about 2 to 3 years after diagnosis. Mm. And then I just couldn't do it anymore.
It gets too hard.
Right,
it gets very hard.
It's hard for them and hard for the caregiver as well.
Exactly, very stressful because you're constantly worried about the individual. And
wandering is a big issue.
Yeah.
Two-thirds of the people with Alzheimer's wander.
Mm-hmm.
And I just had to, I felt I had to know every moment of the day where my wife was and had to keep her by my side.
Right. Well, even my dad, I mean, he had oxygen deprivation. So I imagine me trying to stop him from walking out the door quite a few times. It's like, no, you can't go take a walk around the block. It's not safe. But yeah, it is. It's very difficult on the entire family, but especially the person living in the home. You know, you can't even sleep at night because you're worried they're just going to get up and go outside.
Right.
And some do wander during the night.
Right.
And so then the caregiver gets no uninterrupted sleep whatsoever.
Right. Well, Dave, you brought some phenomenal flyers and literature. And I thank you so very much because I, you know, didn't know the, you know, a lot of the information before.
Right. Yeah. So these are pieces of literature produced by the Alzheimer's Association and, you know.
Well, specifically the caregivers. It's so important. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, caregiving is, as you said, very difficult and it's very stressful.
Yeah.
And in fact, 25%, and this is the percentage that we've been told, 25% of all caregivers die before the person with dementia.
Wow.
And from stress.
Yeah.
And so I made it a point when I learned that, and I learned that in a support group. We can talk about that.
Right.
But I just made a point. I wasn't going to be one of those.
Mm.
And because if I am gone, who's going to take care of my wife?
Right, exactly.
And so I need to be healthy and be able to take care of my wife.
Exactly. Yeah, right. And Dave, there's actually a number that I was floored, 259 billion. It says in
the
brochure.
Mm-hmm. And that's, well, I mean, let me give you an example. Medicare doesn't really pay for my wife's care in a facility. Mm-hmm. However, if my wife was hospitalized, then they will pay for it. And for instance, my wife was hospitalized about 3 years ago because one of the features or problems with Alzheimer's patients is they forget to drink. And so they become dehydrated. And so she became dehydrated and ended up in the hospital for 2 or 3 days and then was able to go back to the care facility. And that's where the care, that's where the Medicare dollars are spent when they're not properly cared for and especially if they were cared for in a home.
Well, and also the, I know that there's no cure right now, but you know the medical professionals are working very hard to do research, right?
Right.
Yes, absolutely.
And when I'm an ambassador for the Alzheimer's Association, and 4 years ago, the Congress was giving about $400 million in research funding to the National Institute of Health.
Mm-hmm.
Now it's up to $1.8 billion. And we're asking for another $425 billion this year. And there's a lot of hope.
Yeah.
There's no cure now, but there's a lot of hope. Mm-hmm. And look what cancer research gets, about $6 billion, and that's wonderful. And they've made major improvements in cancer research. Mm-hmm. And Alzheimer's only gets a little less than $2 billion.
Wow.
So we've got a long way to go, and there's no cure.
But there's hope.
There is hope. And Alzheimer's patients usually live for, well, my wife's lived for 9 years, and she could live for quite a few more years.
Wow, yeah. And I know that there's fundraising involved, too, to try to help financially with the...
There's research going on at Stanford, at UCSF, at the VA in Palo Alto, and that a lot of it is funded through the local chapter of the Alzheimer's Association.
The Alzheimer's Association gives grants to scientists for their research.
Good, good.
So that's why one of the things that the Alzheimer's Association does is raise funds to support not only the association and the work they do with caregivers, mm-hmm. but also for their grants that they give to scientists.
Right. And also, I think that sometimes, like regarding my grandmother, Grandma Kay, she there's a picture of my grandma and I when she was fully cognitive and mm-hmm. thinking pretty clearly. There's my brother too. Anyway, but literally, it's very difficult because as she started progressing and getting. Having a worse memory, she wasn't able to recognize her grandchildren,
mm-hmm. right.
but yet she could sit behind the piano mm-hmm. and play beautifully,
mm-hmm.
like she did, when she was 20 and 25 years old, and I mean, she memorized everything, mm-hmm. and it's incredible,
mm-hmm. Music is one of the last issues.
Right.
It's one of the last areas of the brain that goes.
Yeah.
And so many of them maintain that love of music.
Wow.
When
and
I visit my wife, there's always music going on in the room, and she's kind of bouncing around the music. She doesn't really speak. She doesn't say hello. She doesn't, there's no conversation, but she's kind of bouncing to the music.
Yeah, that's good. Yeah, music is very soothing. It really is. I love it.
Yeah,
absolutely.
And I know that without my wonderful volunteers, we wouldn't have a show. And so I'm very grateful. And I know also the Alzheimer's Association needs lots of volunteers.
Mm-hmm. Right? They do. And,
yes, they
and,
do.
Right.
And, there's an Alzheimer's walk in the fall, and there's something coming up, I think it's right there, concerning the longest day, which is on June 21st.
Right.
And so we all do our, on that particular day, we do things we love to do, but we also try to raise some funds for the
Absolutely.
Alzheimer's Association.
And, I mean, if we don't catch it this time, then, because our show will be showing for many, many years, so thankfully... we will be able to, look at our local mm-hmm. Alzheimer's organizations and find out what is mm-hmm. coming up mm-hmm. in your particular area,
yes.
whether it's San Francisco or
right.
San Jose.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah, right. That's wonderful. And I did actually want to ask you what the address is. Regarding
the website?
The website.
The website is alz.org, www.alz.org.
Oh.
And then you can search for the local chapter, if you remember, / NorCal.
Oh, okay.
But you can find it through alz.org.
Great.
There's multiple chapters across the nation. Mm-hmm. We're the Northern California and Northern Nevada chapter of that.
Oh, that's wonderful.
Right.
And they list all of their support groups on the website, all their resources.
Mm. And their support groups in multiple languages.
Multiple languages. There are support groups in Mandarin. There are support groups in Spanish. And for people with early onset for people with frontal temporal, which is another kind of dementia. So, large variety of different.
Tell us more about that. The frontal temporal.
Frontal temporal dementia is a dementia where the person, along with having some of the behaviors of Alzheimer's in terms of forgetting, they also have visions. They see, they think they see things coming at them. And
that's Lewy body. And, yeah, Lewy body has hallucinations. Frontal temporal, if I remember right, has short-term memory but not long-term memory.
Oh.
Yeah. And I'm confused,
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, my God.
Yeah. So, and there's 100 different kinds of dementias.
Wow.
60% of the people with dementia have Alzheimer's. But there's also, as Betty mentioned, frontal temporal, there's Lewy body, there's
vascular.
There's also some curable and some vitamin. You can get dementia by having a deficiency in vitamin B12. And so that's the reason why everybody is encouraged to get a diagnosis, because you may have a type that is curable.
Yeah. It's not. So it's early detection, really.
It's very important.
Helpful. Yeah. Very important.
Very important. Wow. And some of the meds, there is one med or two meds actually for Alzheimer's that don't really cure it, but they kind of slow it down. But you don't want to give that med for someone with Lewy body, because it does the opposite for someone with Lewy body.
Wow.
So it's important to get a proper diagnosis from a neurologist who understands dementia.
Oh my gosh.
Yeah. So it's not. It's an important thing to do.
Yeah. Well, I apologize, and I'm very sorry to hear that your husband did pass. When did he pass?
Yeah.
How many years ago?
3 years ago.
Wow, okay. So it's very hard on the family.
Oh, certainly.
Yeah,
it affects all the relationships in the family as they see their loved one deteriorate.
So. Right.
Yeah.
And it affects different people differently.
Absolutely.
So, and if you have a large family, then it's even more difficult.
Yeah. And it's hard to understand, hard to deal with a person with dementia many times. You know, my sons, very thankfully, visit their mother quite regularly, and it's wonderful.
Wow, that's great.
It is. I'm very, very thankful that they do. But it does affect the entire, it is a family disease. It affects the entire family.
Exactly, yeah, definitely. And that's why I think it's so important that we get more funding for,
It would be nice to meet the first survivor of Alzheimer's.
Right.
Talk about cancer survivors.
Right.
It would be very nice to have an Alzheimer's survivor.
My worst fear is my children getting it. And Betty's children getting disease. There are some genetic transfers. It's not necessarily the case that if your parents have it, you will, but
there's a higher risk.
It's a higher risk if your parents or one of your parents has it.
Wow.
And so that's really what I'm fighting for, is to get more funding to find a cure. So my children don't get it, and my grandchildren don't get it.
Exactly. Wow. Well, it is wonderful that they come and visit with her, but that's why it's so important that you spread the word and get the word out there that with the what do they call walkathons or.
Walks,
In the fall. Yeah. In the fall, there's always an Alzheimer's walk, and they have them in San Francisco, San Jose, Santa Cruz. All over the country.
Wow.
They establish a day to do that.
Oh, that's fantastic.
And raises
they raise a lot of money.
They raise a lot of money. And it's all for a good cause.
Oh, my gosh.
Absolutely.
Is there like a central location where the most of the research is happening, or?
Well, it's funded. Most of the funding comes through the National Institute of Health.
Mm-hmm.
But they issue grants all over the nation, and there's a lot of research going on in Europe and overseas.
Okay.
This is not a U.S. disease at all.
Oh.
I mean, there's 5.5 million people in the U.S. that have it, but there's many more millions worldwide.
Okay.
So it's a real issue, not just in the U.S. So there's research going on everywhere, and there's clinical trials going on that you can get involved with.
Wow.
My wife was in one.
My husband was in two clinical trials.
Really?
At Stanford VA.
Oh, tell us more about that.
Well, one that I'm very proud of, actually, is we're doing PET scans of the brain, and they would give the patient a dye, and the amyloid plaque in the brain absorbed this dye, and this was a test that is now used to confirm the presence of amyloid plaque, which confirms the presence of Alzheimer's.
Wow.
And my husband was one of the trial patients that was in that study.
Wow.
And when my husband's brain was being scanned, the researcher said, "Whoa, look at that one light up," because his brain was full of the amyloid plaque.
Oh, my gosh.
They believe that Alzheimer's is caused by two things, amyloid plaque and tau protein. And somehow these two things work together. They really don't know how yet. And so Betty's husband took part in this study to show the amyloid plaque. Now they're doing some research to try to show the tau protein in your brain. So they haven't really gotten to the point where they figured out why it works together to cause this, because we all have plaque,
right.
We all have amyloid plaque in our brain. For some reason, the Alzheimer's patients don't slough it off.
Wow.
But they think that they can see now, with this test, they can see the plaque in a person's brain before symptoms of Alzheimer's behavior show themselves. Mm-hmm. And they are looking at people who have amyloid plaque in their brain 10 years before they show any symptoms, and they are saying, this person is a candidate who's going to get Alzheimer's disease because their brain is filled with this plaque. So they now know that they can do this, and they can identify people. They can't do anything for you yet,
right.
But the goal is, if we can catch this disease early on, then maybe we can stop it from progressing to where we see memory loss and all the other issues.
I mean, I'm sure it's not half the battle, but it's hopefully, like, at least if they find out, you know, and they detect that in the brain, then hopefully a cure is really close.
Right.
Hopefully.
Yeah.
Hopefully.
Wow.
Hopefully.
Well, that's exciting that he was a part of that.
It is. It is.
And gives me chills. That's wonderful.
And he would be very proud to know that test is being used now.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh.
He said there was nothing that he could do for himself. He was going to die of Alzheimer's disease.
Yeah.
But he wanted to do something for everyone who followed.
Wow. And he did. Oh, wow. Well, you know, my my mom visited my grandma pretty maybe a couple of years before she passed, and you know, she thought she had a wonderful visit with her, and she was telling her all about my mom was telling my grandma all about what we were doing and all of our activities, and you know, my mom left and hopped back on the plane, and my mom's sister, you know, was still in the room after my mom left, and my grandma said, "Who was that nice lady?"
Right.
And my aunt said, "That's your daughter, Jean." And she's like, "Oh, she was so nice." You know, it's like, wow. You know, and I cried when I heard that. Yeah. I was like, because she was so amazing. But anyway, Dave, I want to thank you so very much for joining us.
Sure.
I greatly appreciate it.
Sure.
And Betty, thank you.
You're very welcome. Nice to be here.
Thank you.
Nice to be here.
Thanks.
Yeah.
And thank you so very much for joining us. Until next time, I'm Donna Yeager with On the Move. Have a wonderful day.
Choose to make a difference. Our time is overdue. If we collect our dreams, take them on the move. We're rolling and we're walking, but we're not sitting still. There's a world of adventure to explore. We're signing and we're talking from New York to Brazil, from Canada on out to Singapore. We're on the move to make this world a better place.